I've been teaching since I was in college. So this biotechnology was a very new stream when I was in engineering. So we used to study through research. We didn't have a specialist for every subject back then, especially in India. So we used to have group study modules, research modules, and we all used to teach each other. I think I started teaching way back then. And the obvious choice was to kind of go abroad after biotech, an undergraduation in biotech, because, you know, the scope was all in the US at that point of time, not like today. So I had written most of my exams, but at that point in time, I had also prepared for GRE with the help of Baiju for math, especially because, and I saw it a very different perspective. I never learned math like that before. In fact, I think I fell in love with the subject with mathematics, you know, back then, because I learned it in a very different way. I realized it's all about common sense. And in the gap from the time I wrote the exam to actually going abroad and completing my post-graduation, Baiju asked me to kind of teach in some of the batches. And when I taught, the first class I took was for about 100 plus students. And the impact it created kind of, you know, gave me a lot of satisfaction. I really liked teaching such a large group of students. I saw the impact it created in their lives. At that point of time, it was to get in to a dream job for them, to support their family. So I saw that impact. I saw, you know, the possibility of redefining the way people learn in the future. So I kind of stayed back, and I've never looked back ever since. We've been doing one thing after the other, but we're all core teachers at heart. We're all content creators at heart. We just use technology along the way to take it to many more places. We've used technology along the way to make it even better, and you know, to make it even more interesting and fun and engaging for students. So from the time I first took my class, where I had to wear a sari to look, you know, a little older than what I actually was, because I was teaching children just a few years younger than me, because they were applying for a job that they really like. I think we've come a really long way. Today, we almost teach only to the camera. I'm still a teacher today. I still take classes. But the difference is that at that point of time, I could have impacted a few thousand students at a time. But today, it's millions at a time, right? So I think that that kind of gives you the kick that you need to keep going again and again and again and on and on and on. In terms of interesting anecdotes, I think at every turning point when we've taken big decisions, like when we decided that we completely stop our offline classes, offline coaching centers, and then completely transition using technology to VSAT, that was a big milestone. It was a big turning point. It was a big decision. But we took it, and then we stood by it, and you know, it happened to be a good one. And again, in 2015, when we had the learning app, which was being launched, I mean, we took a big, bold decision to, in our marketing, to talk about falling in love with learning versus the noise in the market, which is all about toppers and rank holders and coming first in class and all of that. We stood out with the tone of falling in love with learning. I think that's the second big milestone decision, which I would like to say, where it was a big call to take, but then we decided, you know what, we've always been on the side of the students. It makes sense for them to like our product and then use our product, right? And it cannot be just for the motivated few. It has to be learning for everybody. It has to be inclusive learning. So that was the second thing. And we knew we had done something right, because within the first one and a half months since the app launched, we had about 2 million students who had downloaded the app and were learning from us. So we knew that this was something which has a huge potential. And we continue to innovate, we continue to go deeper, and our focus is always on how can we have many more students learn from us, how can we remove the barrier of accessibility, how can we remove the barrier of quality of learning. Everybody should have access to the same high quality learning, because every child deserves that. For the younger age groups, which is from K to 12, which is what I speak for, I do believe that it has to be a blended model. With the best of both the worlds. So even though, you know, literally overnight, educators, schools, institutions, parents, everybody transitioned online overnight, right? We saw a big shift. It didn't take days or months. It didn't even take weeks. It took days when schools had to shut down because of the pandemic. And I think we've realized that, you know, it's very, very beneficial. Online learning can a lot of things can happen online which cannot happen offline, like students now get a front row seat. This would not happen in an offline class. There's no concept of a backbencher, right? It's like this, where everybody is on the same the same pedestal. So that and teachers can also use a lot of interactive tools to teach better, because technology enables you to face your students while teaching it, and enables you to use a lot of you know, interactive 3D interactions to make learning even more impactful, engaging and meaningful for students. You can have a lot of digital games, you can engage the students better. So there's so many things that you can do. But then there are certain subjects, and I always maintain that, like sports and arts, which are best taught offline, are best when people are around you, when the teachers with the students to help them, assess them. Like you can't teach a child how to hold a brush online, right? So you need to have certain things need to happen in the offline world, certain things need to happen in the online world. So I think what institutions can take away from this is that it's possible to have a hybrid model. It could have been ruled out before, but I think that right now there is a possibility to have a hybrid model where you can combine the best of online and offline. Quite surprising that a sector as important, as impactful as education does not have a $100 billion, right? So maybe it's because education as an investment takes time to show, so you don't see results tomorrow. This is something which takes time, but there is a lot of interest, especially because of the pandemic. You know, it's put EdTech in the spotlight, not just in India, but across the world. People are slowly realizing the benefits, and I think there's a lot of scope also, right? It's not just about investor interest, so to say, but I also think there is a lot of scope to do much more today, because most of the stakeholders, be it parents, teachers, institutions, all have moved online, transitioned online. They're able to see the benefits of online learning. So there is space for companies to introduce new products that will aid in making learning effective. So for example, they can help figure out how to help teachers teach better. They can figure out how to help students learn better, which is what we're kind of doing. They can help institutions go online more seamlessly. They can create new formats for reskilling and upskilling. So there's so much that can be done. There is a lot of potential over here, and a golden age of teaching can actually come back because of technology.